Yeah, so the stream winner, the first stage of enlightenment, what does, I'm going to answer it in two parts, kind of like how to get enlightened, and then what was the experience. Because if I explain the experience in yet another way, that's kind of useless. So I'm going to lay out what it takes to reach the stream enlightenment. Exactly what I just said for the first 10 minutes. You gotta know pain. You gotta know thoughts. If any greed arises in the mind, you have to know greed. Any anger arises in the mind, you have to note anger. Just the delusional thoughts, you have to note that as just thoughts. These thoughts kind of delude us every day to think that we're special, you know, and we have this money, we have these relationships. We're deluding ourselves with these kind of random thoughts. You know, we're going to work, we're thinking about work before we get to work. So that's delusional. So we want to note these thoughts. And when you're practicing and you see these thoughts arise, and you note them and they disappear, then the strength, that strength of the delusion becomes less. And so we want greed, hatred, delusion to become less and less and less powerful. So we get to that by noting objectively what it is. To get enlightened, you have to, these days, you have to go to a meditation course. You know, the closest one I know of is, you know, Joseph Goldstein's up in Barre, Massachusetts, Insight Meditation Society. And they were teaching the method taught by Mahasi Sayadaw, a Burmese monk. That monk is one of the most revered in Burma. He is responsible for at least 100,000 Sotapannas, enlightened people. Could be a half a million. Now that's more than what the Buddha produced during the time of the Buddha. The Buddha only produced, you know, say, thousands of enlightened people. This Venerable Mahasi Sayadaw has helped so many Buddhists. In Burma, millions of people practice Vipassana meditation. Millions. The success rate is 50%. So if I divided this room in half and you practiced a 2-3 week meditation period, half of you could attain the first path, the stream enterer. Because this method is very precise and very powerful. How could that yogi that I was just talking to in Austin, in 10 minutes, note away chronic pain? She had nerve damage in her side. She noted it and it went away. Doctors couldn't help and she didn't want to take pain pills. You get rid of physical pain, and by noting you get rid of mental pain. There's two kinds of pain in the world, or in our bodies that we experience. Mental pain and physical pain. Enlightenment cuts off every kind of mental pain. So the arahants experience some physical pain. A mosquito is biting them, they experience that. They're not robots. You know, they can experience the heat, cold water, hot water, they feel that. But there's no mental pain, there's no aversion, there's no grasping and no pushing away. So we want to, you know, get out of this mental pain. Mental pain is suffering. So we have the Four Noble Truths, the truth of suffering, not getting what we want, pain in our body, you know, physical pain and suffering, not getting what we want. And that's not other people's problems. That's our problem. You know, other people don't cause our problems. We create our own problems through our own attachment, anger and attachment. So if we get rid of anger and attachment, there's no suffering. There's no suffering for us. So, these meditation classes, to get enlightened. From the moment you wake up in the morning, you have to note whether you woke up on your in-breath or your out-breath. Then you note the contact of the body in the bed. So you start with the head, go all the way down to the feet. And so you note the head at the pillow, touching, 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 touching. Now you'll notice, when you're doing that, the body relaxes into the pillow. When you're noting the body on the bed, you feel it softening into the bed, relaxing into the bed, from the head down to the feet, touching, 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 touching. If you have any tiredness from waking up, you note that as sort of a tiredness. Feel that sort of mental tiredness. So you note that. After a minute or two, all of that mental tiredness, heaviness in the body will disappear because we're noting it, we're knowing it. Ignorance is one of the roots of our problems. So ignorance is the wrong side or the bad side. Knowledge, knowing, is wisdom. And that helps us to get us enlightened. So we want to be knowledgeable of the present moment. So then we want to get out of bed. There's an intention to get out of bed. Maybe we have to go to work. We have a thought, I have to get to work. Then we get out of bed. So there's a thought before we make any movement. So we have a pain in our knee. Mind tells the body to move, to stretch, because we don't want the pain. So the body stretches due to the mind. So that's mind, then the body moves. So the mind is like the puppeteer, the body is like a puppet. So then we see these two elements. We have a mind, we have a body. It's like the puppeteer and the puppet. So there's always an intention before we move. So then we try to note every intention. So there's an intention to reach for the toothbrush, to bring it back. It's very laborious. If we break down, you know, how many steps it is to brush your teeth. But we want to slow down. If we're in a meditation center, we want to slow down with everything we do. To be mindful, present, and then noting every intention. Noting the squeezing of the toothpaste onto the toothbrush, the bringing of the toothbrush up. We want to train the mind to do just one thing at a time. So we don't want to be eating and looking out the window or watching TV while we eat. When you're eating, you should always be sitting down. You have your bowl of food there. Put your mindfulness in front of you and note, you know, the picking up of each spoonful. Placing in the mouth, noting, chewing, chewing, chewing. And then whenever you swallow, note the swallowing. You should be noting one note per second for the 18 hours of every day that, you know, that you're meditating. That's 3,600 notes per hour. Then you get 18 hours. 1 week is about 500,000 notes. 2 weeks, about 1,000,000. 3 weeks, 1.5 million. From the moment you wake up to the moment you fall asleep. So I haven't even gotten into when you're sitting. So then you alternate the sitting and the walking. When you're walking, you should be walking back and forth in these, like a room like this, you can walk back and forth. Lifting, moving, placing, lifting, moving, placing, lifting, moving, placing. When you come to the end, there has to be an intention to stop. If you don't have an intention to stop, you're going to walk into the wall. So there has to be an intention there to stop. So then there's intention, you try to see that. You try to see these intentions. You may not, but just know that they're there. Then you're standing there, then you note, what's happening right now, in the present moment, I'm standing. Standing, standing, standing. You feel the feet, the contact of the feet on the floor. So we're being grounded again. We want to be grounded continuously. Ground the mind in the body. As close to the ground as you can. So we have the feet on the ground, we feel that pressure. You know, we weigh 150 pounds, more or less. So that's spread out on 2 feet. So we get 75 pounds per foot. So we feel that weight. Then we feel like, is this cool? The floor cool? Or if you're on a rug, it's soft, you feel the softness. Then if you're walking from wood to carpet, you feel the softness, you feel the hardness. You want to investigate the Dhamma. Investigate what's happening every present moment. So if you're walking and you start thinking, you have to note. Stop walking, concentrate on the thinking, just note, thinking, 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 then come back, okay, I'm ready to walk. Feel the foot lifting, moving, placing, lifting, moving, placing. So when you come to the end and you want to turn to the left or to the right, which way are you going to turn? One of my friends said to the right. So that's kind of a joke. Which way? It's like, oh, I always turn to the right. But you can turn, you have a choice, left or right. So you stand in there, then you have to decide, what's the intention? Is the intention to turn to the left or turn to the right? Which one? So then you're standing there for 2 or 3 minutes, and people think you're crazy or, you know, something's wrong with you. You're just standing there facing a wall. So that's good. And let them think that. So either you see the intention or you don't, so you turn. Then you're standing again. Then you have to take a step. Is it going to be the left foot or the right foot? And don't say right or left. You have to, because that's when we're unmindful, it's just, we don't even know what's happening. Is it left foot, right foot? I don't know. So we've tried to see the intention. Is it the right foot or left foot? So, okay, we start with the right. Lift it up, place it forward, feel it touch. Left, right, lifting, moving, placing. Trying to see the intention. When you're taking walks outside, try to go from one car to the next car without thinking. Go from one parking meter to another parking meter. Go from one tree to another tree without thinking. And check yourself to see just how much thoughts are controlling you or under your influence or influencing you. And if it's too many thoughts, just stop. Collect yourself. Because we only want to do one thing at a time. So we don't want to be walking and thinking. If you want to think, stand there. Note, thinking, thinking, thinking. Okay, now I'm going to start again. Lifting, moving, placing, or left, right. So we want to alternate the sitting and the walking. Again, that's about 60,000 notes per day. That's what it takes. To reach the first path. So I hope that's helpful. But it's possible these days to reach that Sotapanna state. Again, it's at least 100,000 Sotapannas in the world today. And they all practiced exactly what I said. It could go up to 500,000. Enlightened people today. So again, that's more than during the Buddha's time. And it's more than during the Sri Lankan period also. Yarahant Mahinda starting Buddhism in Sri Lanka. There were said to be many Arahants at that time. There's probably more enlightened people this time. Again, that monk Mahasi Sato, one of the most important monks during this Buddha period. So, I don't know how specific, I have a few pages of the Sotapanna experience or what they have. So some of it's kind of technical, but I want to make a list and have everything in there. Sotapanna understands that there is just a mind and a body. That's all. In popular culture, what do we say? Mind, body, spirit. Mind, body, soul. We add that extra little thing. That's the Sotapanna knows that there's just these two things, mind and body. That's the beginning of understanding that there's no soul, no self. The Sotapanna understands, or stream enterer, understands that all things are impermanent. What's impermanent is unsatisfactory. What's impermanent and unsatisfactory is not self. You can't own it. I can't own this body. It lasts for 80 years, more or less, and it'll pass away. Stream Wonder understands the Four Noble Truths. Noble Truth of Suffering, the cause of suffering, which is attachment, the cessation of suffering, which is nirvana, enlightenment, and then the path, the Eightfold Path, starting with right view, going to right mindfulness. Enlightenment itself, they say a cessation of suffering. Enlightenment is it's also called the cessation of mind, cessation of consciousness. So it's actually the disappearance of consciousness. It is enlightenment. So by noting objects that arise in the body, those objects disappear. Noting objects in the mind, those objects disappear. You note the mind disappears. So the noting is paramount to reaching nibbana. And nibbana is taught to be in the negative, the unborn, uncreated, unoriginated, taught in the negative terms. But let's give it some positive terms. Nibbana is the highest bliss, the highest happiness, the highest peace, the highest purity of mind that you can experience. Completely is a state in which there is absolutely not a single point particle of greed, hatred, or delusion. It's the extreme peaceful state, extremely pure state. So when we're doing yoga and eating vegan and all these kinds of things, we're trying to purify our body through taking these things. By purifying the mind, by noting, you reach the real purity, purity of the mind. Be incapable of killing any person, any animal, stealing anything. You'd have to be completely chaste. You know, the thought of greed would not even arise. This is for the arahant. So the Sotapanna would not be able to break the five precepts, likes to keep the five precepts. So abstaining from killing people, animals, abstaining from stealing, abstaining from sexual misconduct, lying, and the taking of drugs and alcohol. So they would not fall into, you know, some kind of a heroin or alcoholic kind of state. They would be above that. So a Sotapanna can have, you can have, in one way, three kinds of Sotapanna. You can have a Sotapanna that comes back to the human world seven times. You can have a Sotapanna that comes back to the human world two or three times. You can have a Sotapanna that comes back to the world one time. There's also another three kinds of Sotapanna. One Sotapanna sees impermanence before their enlightenment. Another type of Sotapanna sees desirelessness or suffering before their enlightenment. The wisdom type sees no self or the void before going into enlightenment. So they would say to themselves, there is no self, there is no self. Then the mind would go into experience nibbana. Most of the people in the world are the first type of people, the people that see impermanence. This mind and body is impermanent. That the statistics are 70% of yogis who attain see the impermanence of this mind and body. About 10% see that this is suffering, so they would see this mind and body as suffering. This is suffering, this is suffering. Then the third type would be about 20%. There is no self, there is no self. This is just a process. And then they would attain cessation of consciousness. That cessation, the first one, that had been never been experienced in their life, you know, for millions and millions of lifetimes. That point of cessation. It's been a continuous stream of mind arising and passing away. Never before experienced this cessation. That stream winner is higher than any king, higher than any billionaire, higher than any deva, heavenly being, higher than any Brahma. They're equal to today's enlightened Sotapanna, is equal to those Sotapannas during the Buddha's time. So Abhante Ananda was a Sotapanna for 45 years. He became an arahant. Anantapindika and Visakha, the chief lay disciples. So those were Sotapannas during the Buddha's time. Very famous, many stories about them. A person today is equal to those. When they died, they went to the higher heavenly worlds. So if you attain that, you would be equal to those. Very famous people. The first monk that got enlightened to the Sotapanna was Kandanya. The Dhammacakka Sutta was directed at him, and he attained during that Dhammacakka Sutta. At that moment of his enlightenment, all the heavenly beings from the lower levels, all the way up to the Brahma beings, all exclaimed, "No, Kandanya has understood. This first person to attain enlightenment under the Buddha." Same thing goes today. Anybody who attains that, the heavenly beings see that. It's the same kind of earthquake effect that goes through the heavenly worlds and the Brahma worlds. I like, in Las Vegas, they have the Luxor with a big light in it. The pyramid. So there's a light that goes up pretty high through space for miles and miles. You can use that as an image that whenever there's an enlightened person, there's a light that goes up, which can be seen from all the heavenly beings. So that's an illustration of it. There's 10 to 15 persons like that attaining every day. It's still happening today. In the next 100 years, there could be like another 100,000 to 500,000, which that would make a nice even number, 1 million enlightened people at this time period. So, you know, and for you that are still practicing to get that, you can be of that number. I think it's important that you know that it's possible for you to attain. Upandita Sayadaw wrote a book, In This Very Life. He means enlightenment in this very life. So it's a very positive attitude. But I know there's a lot of monks who deny that. I mean, they'll give a big Dhamma talk. Well, and lay teachers also can't get enlightened in this lifetime. That is wrong view. It prevents people, stops people from practicing. So I like to think I have a positive attitude in some ways. The Sotapanna cannot fall into the four lower worlds. So they can't, that's very important. You can't fall into the hell worlds, you can't become an animal, you can't go to the hungry ghost level or the angry spirit level. So those doors are closed permanently. If the Sotapanna in their next life, if they want to go to the heavenly world, they can go to the heavenly world. If you want to be born in this world, you like the United States, you can be born in the United States. From the heavenly world, you won't fall back to this human world. Once you're there, there's no falling back. You go from one deva world to another deva world until you reach the next stage of enlightenment, then the next stage after that. The Sotapanna is guaranteed progress from one path to the second path, third path, fourth path. That can't be denied. That's it's a natural truth. They can't fall down to the lower worlds. They can only go up. So Visakha and Ananda Pindaka, they had the wish that they would go from deva world to deva world, that they would have the happiest, longest lifespan. And so that's their wish. People who are not enlightened can't achieve that kind of a wish, because there's too much ignorance, greed, hatred, and delusion. Now we go from one life to another, maybe we're doing good for a while, we get caught up with a bad crowd, we start drinking, then we're married, and then we want to be with someone else, so we start breaking these five precepts, then all of a sudden our happy existence ends, and then there's payment, the karma payment. We fall down to a lower world due to our inappropriate actions. The Sotapanna cuts off three fetters: personality, belief, skeptical doubt, and attachment to rites and rituals. So they have right view. Right view is that there is no self, and so the self view is cut off. They still may have an idea that they are, if I'm Bhante Nalaka, I still have, if someone says Nalaka, I say yes. So there's still a sense of identity. Consciousness and perception is still there, that there's a self, but the view of having a self is cut. And it's a subtle, it's not until the arahant completely cuts off, like this self-identity with this mind and body. They're completely objective towards it. So they don't suffer. Body changes, body gets old, body dies. That's the nature. No problem. So the Sotapanna, like I said before, likes to keep the five precepts. There was one monk called Tunkulu Sayadaw, was asked a question: how do you achieve world peace? His answer was by keeping the five precepts. Just abstain from killing. Ah, that's very, sounds good. Abstain from stealing. Abstain from sexual misconduct. Abstain from lying. And abstain from drugs and alcohol. World peace. Just like that. So if we had a world of sotapannas, it would be a really great place. But it's very simple. I mean, the Buddha's teaching from the very lowest part of just morality, achieves world peace. So how much more, you know, by developing the meditation, you can see Nibbana itself. You know, it just goes from better to better, to higher, from higher to higher. The bold, unwholesome actions the Sotapanna had done, the effects of those are all eliminated. So if the Sotapanna had killed animals earlier in his life, those actions which would have led to a lower world, those actions, the actions cannot be, you can't feel the result of that. So what would lead a Sotapanna to a lower world? Previous actions, he cannot go to the lower world. So all that, so in past lives, we've done so many things in past lives, all that accumulated karma, action, is eliminated. So that's one of the other great benefits. You know, one of the requisites for attaining in this life is a Pali word called chanda, or dhamma chanda. It is the desire to obtain, desire to attain, desire to reach, desire to fulfill, desire to accomplish, extreme or excessive desire. Such desire is appeased if it is fulfilled, as in the case of King Bimbisara, Visakha, and Natapindika. Meaning, these people during the Buddha's time, they hear that there's a Buddha from a friend. You said that there's a Buddha? I said there's a Buddha. Did you say there's a Buddha? I said there's a Buddha. Did you say there's a Buddha? I said there's a Buddha. Just hearing the word the Buddha, a great faith arises. They have to meet, that's their number one goal, is to meet the Buddha as quickly as possible. If it's at night and they have to wait until the morning to visit the Buddha, they won't be able to sleep. So that is this desire. So I'm laying out, there is a goal. The Sotapanna, the stream winner, is attainable in this life. If you have that chanda, you'll say, how can I get there? Where do I have to meditate? And you put everything else on the back burner. Nothing can get in your way of heading to try to go to one of these courses. You need that kind of determination, willpower. And with that, you can bear up any kind of pain that arises. You push through, you follow the instructions, and you make that attainment. So that concludes my I talk on the stream winner. And I say, yes, sir.
It sounds like when a person enters the stream, that it's like a law that goes into the stream and it gets taken. It seems as if you started a process that takes you. And before you even started, you had an option of not going into it or something. But since the person was heading towards it, there's no turning back. They just get pulled in. Is that true? Is that what it means? Or
Let's see. Well, one of my friends was told by his teacher that, you know, once you get started with this and you attain, there's no coming back. And my friend was like, let's go, let's do it. So he warned him. I was like, no. And then he made the choice, and he attained the thing. But yeah, these are very, 1956 was the halfway point in the Buddha Sasana. So the length of the teachings of the Buddha is supposed to last 5,000 years. 1956 is the year 2500. So this is a great kind of revival, Buddhist renaissance. You know, we're here sitting on cushions, and there's hundreds of meditation centers all over the world, and everybody's doing meditation in different ways. You know, the Anapanasati, doing loving kindness, you know, various kinds of meditation practices. But 100 years ago, there was nothing like this in the United States. And even in the other countries, it only got revived kind of around starting in the 30s, and it really picked up a head of steam in the 50s. And then there's our love generation, you know, now everybody's 60 to 75, you know, going to India to practice, you know, the Beatles and all that. It's like, you know, well, let's look at this religion, this practice, you know. There must be something there. And that was kind of my practice. I mean, if I hear that there's something out there, it's like, well, what is it? How good is it? You know, there's enlightenment. Okay, what is it? How do you get there? And then, you know, you experience these things. It's like, and, you know, I can ask you later, you know, as well, is that the highest bliss? Is that the highest happiness? And if you experienced it, you know, for yourself, without having anybody tell you, yeah, that's the highest. There's a states of concentration that bring about high states of bliss. If you picture every atom in your body exploding with bliss, that's the peak of concentration meditation. Nirvana, Nibbana, enlightenment is higher than that. The experience of enlightenment is more like throwing down a burden. It's different than having your body erupting in bliss, rapture. So it's different, it's subtle, but the throwing down of the burden is superior. But again, the Buddha said, come and see, check it for yourself. You should try to do all these different meditations. Get the rapture. Okay, got it. Get the first path. All right, yeah, that's pretty good. And you know, then try for the second, third. So Buddhism isn't negative. It's not all suffering. You know, there's some good stuff. Yes.
Bhante, the statistic about 100,000 people practicing the Mahasi method and becoming Sotapannas?
Yes.
Where is that from, exactly?
It's like data of like how many people meditate in Burma. It's in the millions. The success rate comes from like the Mahasi centers. And so you get that 50% projectile. Sri Lanka is the same way. So I lived in a meditation center for 2.5 years. I know the teacher's meditation, their own teacher's practice, as well as I know my own. So I was privy to this information. They have books in which all the yogis have a name, and then there's insight categories on it, starting with the Nama Rupa, the mind and body arising and passing away, up to the enlightenment. And there's check marks. Next up. And the book is, now there's 50,000 people in these different books.
Now how do they measure that?
Huh?
How do you measure that? How do you know this guy is Sotapanna, this guy is not a Sotapanna?
Yeah, it's their experiences. Everything is, in Buddhism and meditation, everything is a cause and effect. So you start out seeing that there's a mind and body. If they don't have that, you don't go any further. Then you see there's a cause and effect with the mind and body. You see the arising and passing away, which is a very blissful state. So these signposts have been written about in different suttas. The Visuddhimagga, the whole third chapter, deals with all these insights. And as you're studying them, it's like one causes the next causes the fourth one causes the fifth one. And if a person is dishonest, you can tell if somebody's trying to explain an enlightenment and they don't have it, you can't fake it very easily. But yeah, there's just a lot of data. Even in the very old days, Ledi Sayadaw from Burma had written a few of these manuals of insight. So he kind of predates this whole Vipassana insight period. But he was saying that it's possible for 20, 30, 40, 50% of people who practice attain. So that was even before meditation really got going. So this is just a very, very special period of time. I mean, just with our technology and everything, we've never seen anything like it the past 200 years. So also this renaissance of Buddhism and everybody practicing. I mean, in Texas, you couldn't practice 200 years ago. You'd have, an Indian with a bow and arrow, just kind of, oh, look at that. A sitting target or whatever. So. Yes.
Oh, well, thank you very much for the talk. It's definitely a much more optimistic view of this whole path than I've ever heard. So thank you for that. My question is about the role and importance of the teacher on this practice. How important do you think it is to kind of have one teacher? I know you mentioned going to like a meditation retreat for a couple of weeks, but is it also important to just have one consistent teacher that you can meet on a regular basis?
It depends what the teacher is teaching. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of teachers who don't know what they're doing. So if you're getting wrong practice or the wrong idea, no matter how much you practice, you can't hit the mark, you can't reach the goal. So there's a lot of misinformation, and teachers who aren't really teachers, maybe they write a book, they're more scholarly, but they haven't done the practice themselves. But there's some teachers who, you want to find one that's enlightened. That's the number one thing. And then they can teach you how to get to reach that state also. So I would say Mahasi Sayadaw is enlightened and teaches the way to enlightenment. So a teacher teaching those techniques would direct you in the right direction. And that teacher could be enlightened or unenlightened, but if they're teaching the right method, then it's right. It's all the Satipatthana Sutta, the Four Foundations of Mindfulness. It's very deep, and You just can't wing it. You know, if I told you, be mindful of sitting, be mindful of your eating, be mindful of walking, those kinds of instructions, you will never get anywhere with that. You need the precision, one note per second. Noting every intention, noting whether you wake up on your in-breath or your out-breath. It takes that kind of concentration, mindfulness, that technique of noting that makes you attain. If you don't note, you won't attain. So if you're noting every, like, this lifting, moving, placing, if you're just walking very slowly, but you're not noting that, you won't attain. I mean, I wish that you could, like, but there's the way, there's the soul way, you know. That's what the Buddha said, this is the soul way. And you have to be this detailed. If you're kind of just 50% mindfulness, you can't get it. It's kind of like starting a fire with two sticks. You need constant pressure, effort to make a fire. If you kind of start it very fast and then you stop, start very fast, can't do it. Like if you just sat 1 hour a day and that's all, and just note that, you can't. You can't get it. But if you do 2 or 3 weeks, you can.
Sorry, just a quick follow-up question. So where does the insight, like the Vipassana practice, fit into this? I mean, it seems like this is more of like just, you know, noting. It seems closer to like the breath meditation practice. So is there like, where does, I guess, the Vipassana practice fit in? Or?
Well, Vipassana just means like mindfulness. So we want to be mindful of everything that we do. So if we're eating, we would note every little detail of like what we're doing when we're eating. So you're reaching, you're bringing, putting the food in your mouth. You note the chewing, swallowing. That's mindfulness, that's noting. And that's Satipatthana, four foundations of mindfulness. Yeah, just noting the anapana, that's not enough either. If you're just doing anapana, a lot of people focus on that. You'll reach great states of bliss, but it tends towards concentration. And there's monks who practice in Sri Lanka, and they say, you know, if you're doing this anapana practice, it may take 200 or 300 years to reach like these high states of samadhi. Well, that means, you know, we don't live that long, you know, so it's basically not capable in this life, and we don't know what's going to happen in the next life. We're born somewhere, again, we have bad friends, they can lead us the wrong way. People can attain, I can go into time period, but people can attain enlightenment in 2 or 3 weeks, or a couple months. And it just depends on, again, how much effort, consistent effort that you're doing. Masi Sayadaw even said in there's an online thing of answers, questions and answers with Masi Sayadaw. And they said, oh, you must be, this was about 1950. So his yogis would say, you must be like one of the best meditators. And he had been a scholar. He has like his PhD, Agha Maha Pandita. I mean, these highest intellectual labels. But that got in his way. So actually, the more smart you are, or with whatever labels you have, the slower you're going to be, because if there's any kind of conceit, I'm better than this, or I know, the teacher doesn't know. So it took him 5 weeks, a month and one week, just to get started, because he had doubts about the practice. So he has students that attain in a week, 5 days, 4 days. In Sri Lanka, there's people who arrive in the morning, they get enlightened by the evening. One of my friends got enlightened in actually 1 hour in Sri Lanka, so an American. But he had practiced. There's always a reason, there's a cause. How did he get that? He practiced Vipassana in his past life. He reached to a high level, he didn't get enlightened, but as soon as he started practicing in this life, he got it. So, if we did work, if any of you did work in your past life, if you're here, there's a good chance you have done something. So again, you have to reach that 1.5 million mark. If you did 1 million, then you can get enlightened in a week. Because all this wholesome action stays with us from lifetime to lifetime. You know, how did Sariputta get enlightened? By just listening to one gata, one sentence. Many, many past lifetimes he's practicing Vipassana, and he reached this highest level of mundane mindfulness and mundane wisdom. So that all he needed was just a sentence. All things are impermanent. What's impermanent is unsatisfactory. Boom, he gets enlightened. So there's many people like that. So there's people who just by listening to a little bit, get enlightened. There's some like the Venerable Kundanya, through the time of it takes to recite a sutta, he got enlightened. So with an explanation, you can get enlightened. So by listening to the Dhamma, you can get enlightened. These days, it takes practice. We have to do this laborious, very laborious, lifting, moving, placing. As it's so mundane also. I mean, we're brushing our teeth, we're eating nacho chips, and just chewing. Very, very mundane, but the noting of it leads to, again, this highest bliss, this highest happiness. But that's why we have all these meditation centers. So the first two kinds of people don't exist anymore. Just by listening to the Dhamma, they get enlightened. But the practice part. So, and however far you go in this life, how much you practice this life, again, you carry that to the next life. So maybe you didn't get it this life. You'll be like the top people, that I'm referencing. One day, 7 days. Dipama was just 6 days. Nani Barua, you know the Dipama story? All right, 6 days for Sotapanna. And she was an extremely sickly, horrible condition. Elderly, bad heart, high blood pressure, in a state of depression, she lost her husband. She could barely walk. When she went to the meditation center, she could barely walk. And yet she practiced. And so her attainment, again, she's another person that when you get enlightened, you heal the body. Healthy mind, healthy body. Then she went home for 3 weeks. She came back, and then another 6 days, she reached the second path. So that's not even the fastest attainment I've heard of. That's really great. 2 weeks for two paths. There's an American who reached the first path in 1 week. 2 weeks later, he attained the second. So in a 3 week period of meditating, he reached two paths. So he became a once return. That's just an average, when you say it's an average American, but he had practiced in his past life. He had reached a state in which he understood that there's just this mind and body, and that there's a cause and effect, that there's an intention before you make a movement. So he had that in his last life. So as soon as he starts walking, it's just automatic, and all these insight knowledges arise. one of the best, the teacher at the center said he's one of the best meditators, so he could attain arahant in this life. But he was a newlywed. So, I mean, he just got married, and he wanted to support his wife and parents and this and that and have kids. And so he was just told to stop. That, you know, when he gets older, he can practice again. One of the best. So, I'm glad everybody's here. I tried to put on a good talk. I know you probably never heard anything like this before. But that's why you want to listen to, you know, many different people. And amongst you, you get a new perspective. But I hope that mine was unique and profitable for all of you. The unwholesome is unprofitable. The wholesome is profitable. I'm always interested in profit. Yeah, well, especially when I was a layperson, or and as a monk. What's profitable? What's unprofitable? Okay, leave aside the unprofitable. Catch the profitable. So, may all of you attain.